Next one up is Jean-Christophe Lechesnais. He's going to talk about a fast verified liveness analysis in SSA form.
Thank you for the introduction. So yes, I'm Jean-Christophe Lechesnais, and this is joint work with Sandrine Blasi and David Pichardi. And I will present our work about the verification of an interesting liveness analysis. So our context is in the work is in the our work is in the context of verified compilation. So as you know, a compiler is a program that turns a source program into a target program, typically in a low-level language. So a formally verified compiler is the same thing, except that it comes with a machine checked proof of correctness, typically in a proof assistant, guaranteeing that the target program has the same behavior as the source program. So here are a few examples of well-known verified compilers. So there are Concert, KKML, and BellVM. But the compiler is not a single block like this. It's actually typically a composition of multiple passes that transforms the initial program little by little, going through intermediate languages. And each of these paths may use static analysis to perform more precise transformations. Verified compilers reuse the standard architecture, so as a composition of passes. What is more interesting is that they also use a composition of proof, so the proof of correctness of the whole compiler is the composition of the proof of each pass. And again, the paths can use static analysis, but in this case, they must be verified. So when such static analysis that is standard is liveness analysis, which is used, for example, in code elimination and register allocation. And the goal of this analysis is to detect a live variable, that is to say, a variable whose value is used in the future. So for instance, if we consider this program, before instruction 2, X is live because it is used just afterwards in instruction 2. Before instruction 3, X is dead because it is redefined in 3, so its current value is useless. Before instruction 4, like in the first case, X is live because it is used in 4. And before instruction 5, X is dead because it is not used later in the program. So some liveness analysis was already integrated into the into some verified compilers. So what has been verified is the classic approach using a backward data flow analysis that propagates information from the uses and the backwards in the control flow graph of the program. So the result is a map associating to each program point a set of live variables. And for instance, there is a verified liveness analysis in Concert and in KKML. But in 2008, a new approach was proposed by Boissino et al. That they called liveness checking. So this is quite different from a standard liveness analysis. In particular, it is not a monolithic analysis computing the liveness everywhere at once. Instead, it allows to answer so-called liveness queries of the form, is the given variable live at a given point? It is claimed to be fast if the number of queries is low, and its particularities, it's applicable only to SSFM programs, so I will say more in a minute. And it has not been verified yet in a verified compiler. It has not been integrated yet in a verified compiler. So first, let me give a few words about SSA. So it's a popular compiler intermediate representation that allows to write simpler and faster analysis. So SSA means a static single assignment. So that means that each variable is defined only once in the program. So if we have a program that is not in SSA, like the program below, where we have three assignments to X, and turn it into SSA by renaming the variable into X0, X1, X2, and now we just have one assignment for each. But now the question is, in four, which version of X should we use? And for that, SSA introduces special finite adjunction points that select the right version of the variable depending on where the flow comes from. So for example, here, if we come from 2, it will select X1. And if we come from 3, it will select X2. So to integrate the Boissino et al.'s approach, one could think of Concert because it's one of the best known verified compilers. It's a formally verified compiler initiated by Xavier Leroy, whose first public release was in 2008. It's programmed on Proof, it's a code proof assistant. It has 11 intermediate languages and 20 passes. So here is a brief overview of Concert's compilation chain. It takes as input a program in C. After a few passes, it turns it into RTL, where most of the optimizations are made. And after a few other passes, it, Concert does not have an SSA form, so it is not a good candidate that requires program in SSA. Fortunately, there's a fork of Concert with an SSA middle end. It's called Concert SSA. That was initiated during, actually, it modifies Concert's compilation chain by, currently, it only adds passes. So after RTL on this optimization, there's an SSA generation pass that turns the program into SSA, where SSA-specific transformations can be applied. And after that, an SSA destruction phase pass turn the program back into RTL on the standard Concert compilation chain. So our contribution, our work consisted in formalized Boissino et al.'s approach called live net checking in Concert SSA. And since we are in verified compilation, this means both implement it and prove it correct. So in the rest of the talk, I will first give the idea of live net checking. I won't go into detail because I don't have the time. Then I will explain how we formalized it in Concert SSA. And then I will show benchmarks comparing this approach with respect to the classic one to verify if it's really faster than the classic one. So the property of SSA is that justifies the live net checking approach is a dominance property. So if we consider a somewhat restricted form of SSA, strict SSA, where we forbid undefined variables, so in strict SSA, we can say that each variable must be defined before being used. And if we rephrase that, this can be give a pass from the entry to a use must necessarily go through the definition of the variable. And it's here, and actually here we can see the definition of dominance that I will recall just after. So in strict SSA form, we have this dominance property that each use is strictly dominated by its definition. So yes, let me recall the formal definition of dominance, which says that node U dominates node V. If every pass from entry to V contains U, and it strictly dominates V if the more U and V are different. So here is a small CFG. For example, we can see that 2 dominates 5, since we necessarily need to go through 2 if we have a pass from 1 to 5. And, for example, 5 does not dominate 9 because we have this pass 1, 2, 3, 4, 9 that connects 1 and 9 and does not contain 5. So before going further, I also need to introduce the formal definition of liveness before I give you only the intuition. So formally, it is defined on the control flow graph as follows. So we say that a variable is live at node U if there is a pass from Q to node U where A is used, and that pass does not contain a definition of A. So here, now our CFG is annotated with a SSI instruction. So we have three variables X0, X1, X2. With a fine node in node 3. And if we apply the definition, I forgot to mention, if we are in SSA, we can be more precise. Instead of not does not contain a definition, we can say does not contain the definition, because we know that there is only one. And so in this example, we can say that X1 is live at 5, since we have this path 574. On the contrary, X2 is dead at 5, because we cannot reach a use of X2 without going through the assignments to X2 in 9. So now, how these two ideas combine, so the dominance property of SSA and the liveness and the definition of liveness in terms of paths. So I will try to give an intuition in a simple case. So if we here we will assume that the CFG is a acyclic. So if we consider a variable, we have and D its definition point, and U when use point of this variable. Per the dominance property, we know that U is strictly dominated by D. Now, let us consider another point Q and assume that it's not strictly dominated by D. Actually, so to know if the variable is live at Q, we must find a path from Q to U. But by definition of dominance, this path will necessarily go through D. And this, this gives us the result that the variable is dead in Q. Now let us consider the case where Q is strictly dominated by D. We can show, since the graph is a cyclic, that if there is a path connecting Q and U, all of its points are dominated by D, and in particular, the path does not contain D, meaning that the path shows that the variable is live at Q. So the conclusion of this slide is that the problem is simple in the absence of packages. It's just a matter of dominance and the reachability information. But and that's why, as we will see, Boissineau is specially differently from the other entities. So. Yes, let's get into the core of liveness checking. So the Boissineau et al. Approach consists in two parts, like the classic liveness analysis. But this pre-computation depends only on the graph structure of the CFG, and in particular, on the loop structure, but it does not depend on the instruction in the node of the CFG. And the second part is the online part that actually answered the queries, and it uses the result of the pre-computation part to answer them efficiently. The pre-computation consists in two relations. But first, I have said, we treat package a bit specially, so we give a name to the CFG without the package, which we call the reduced graph. It associates to another V a set of interesting package targets, and formally it is defined as the reflexive and transitive closure of relation TRO. And TRO associates to another. The set of package targets which are not reduced reachable from it. So to we hear about this definition. All V in the reduced graph X are the target of the package V. Since U and V can also reach V, V is not added in their TRO. Since the plugin index cannot reach V, V appeared in their TRO. It's clear. But we can apply this definition on our running example. So if we consider node 4, it can reach 7, which is the source of the bucket 7.4, but it can already reach 4, so we don't add 4 in it. And it can reach 10, which is the source of bucket 10.3, and it cannot reach 3, so we add 3. Similarly, we can show that the TRO of 5 contains 4, and we can do the same for the other nodes. And then T is just the reflexive and transitive closure of TRO. So we get that for this example. So the second part of Boissino et al.'s approach is the online part. So I won't go into detail, but here is the algorithm proposed by Boissino et al. So given a variable A on the node Q, we get TQ. We filter it to keep only the nodes that are strictly dominated by the definition. And for each node T in TQA, the resulting set TQA, we test if it can reach a use of A in the reduced graph. If it's the case, we return true, the variable is live. Else, we return false, the variable is dead. So if I use again my running example and consider node 5 and variable x0, equal to 3, and x0 is used in 2. So the question is whether 2 reduce reachable from either 3, 4, and 5. And the answer is no, the variable is dead. If we do the same for x1, we have a TQA of 4, 5, and the x1 is used in 4 and 9. And of course, 4 is reduced reachable from 4. So the variable is live, and if you consider x2, actually the TQA is empty, so without going further, we can say the variable is dead. So now let's see how we formalized it in Concert SSA. So the first part, two steps. So the first step formalizes computes R on TRO in one pass. And the second step computes T from TRO. So R on TRO are computed in one DFS. So we have one main difference with Boissino et al. In the storage of the relation R. Actually, they suggest to store R explicitly on using bit sets. But since the CFG in Concert have the particularity of not using blocks, they are bigger. So instead, we decided to reuse Boissino et al.'s idea of decomposing. So they suggest to decompose the CFG into the CFG and the package. We decided to decompose into the package, and we decided to decompose the graph into the spanning tree on the cross edge. So this gives a decomposition of R into two relations R and C, where R is the reachability, but only in the spanning tree. And we know how to do that efficiently using two integers per node. On the relation C, as well. So a DFS is not straightforward to implement in Coq because we must show that it terminates and we must be able to reason about it. So to implement the DFS, we actually reuse the structure of another file in Concert called PostOrder that performs a PostOrder numbering of a CFG. So the idea is on either return the final result or another state. Then we can iterate this transition function until it gives the final result, and we provide a proof here that that this process terminates. The state itself contains two graphs, a worklist of nodes to be processed, and the data needed for the DFS. And we just reuse the structure, but with more information. So we have four objects. R, which encodes relation R, C, which encodes relation C, T, markup which encodes T arrow on the list of baggage back. Otherwise, we still have the graph. The worklist is a bit more complex since we also store some more information in it. But otherwise, the rest is similar. We define this transition function and we iterate it until it gives the final result. This way of defining the deep source search, but also in terms of verification, since it's actually quite easy to define an invariant, a postcondition, show that the transition function preserves the invariant or establish the postcondition. So we just have to prove one step, and then we have a theorem stating that the full DFS reach a postcondition at the end. So the second part is the computation of T from T arrow. We follow Boissino et al.'s suggestion to do that in two steps. So the first step is for baggage targets. There we must do that precisely using a DFS preorder, and then we can do the computation for the other nodes in any order. And actually, the proof of the first part was non-trivial because of this order that we must follow. So in terms of definition, it's just for the left on the list of baggage. But the invariant is quite subtle. And actually, for simplicity, we reuse again the structure of post-order, but only for the proof. But it worked quite well. So we have two main theorems for this pre-computation part. The first one states that R on C correctly captures the reduced reachability information. So here it says that U and V are related using R on C if and only if V is reduced reachable from U. And we have two technical assumptions that U is reachable from U and U is in the graph, but basically the idea is there. And here is a theorem for T, so I won't detail, but here it's just a translation of the definition of T arrow in Coq. And then we show that U and V are related using T, if and only if they're related using the reflective and transitive closure of T arrow, that is T. So I won't go into detail about the online part, since it was relatively straightforward. Actually, it's just the algorithm of Boissino et al., but in functional style. The proofs were similar to the original one, with one exception. So it's a proof which starts with, let us consider a path with a minimal number of packages. And this kind of proof is not straightforward to translate into Coq. So instead, we perform another proof by induction on the path. And finally, we have the correctness theorem we expect, which says that if we consider a function that is well-formed, and if we perform the analysis, the analysis returns true for variable A on point U if and only if A is live at U. But we wanted not only to have a correct approach, but also we wanted it to be efficient. For that, to ensure that, to be sure of that, we compare it with respect to the classic approach, the data-flow-based one, implemented using module Kiltal of Frontier. For that, we needed a set of queries. And for our experiments, we just used an artificial criterion, and we made one query per variable and per loop header. So here is the result for the pre-computation part. So for the pre-computation, we compared the pre-computation of our approach with the standard analysis, which does more things. So we expect to be faster, but it's a bit biased because we compute less things. And indeed, so this graph shows the time of our analysis divided by the time of the standard analysis. And since we are below one, we are faster, but this is expected. The question is, when we take into account the queries where we are supposed to be slower than the standard approach, since in the standard approach it is enough, it is sufficient to just read in the table, whereas we must use this online algorithm I've shown to you. So the question is whether the trade-off is in our favor. And with the set of queries considered, this is the case since we can see that most of the times we are faster. So to conclude, I presented to you the formalization in ComSurfSSR of an approach called live net checking that comes with a non-trivial justification involving the dominance property of SSA and graph theoretic arguments about depth of search and dominance. Actually, there's a second implementation that is a bit more optimized that I did not present, but it's formalized too, and it can skip not by unit dominance more. In terms of proof effort, the pre-computation was really more, I don't know, it's more difficult, at least more long than the online part. So it is a 2,000 lines of spec and 4,000 lines of proof, while the online part is only 200 lines of spec and 1,000 lines of proof. In terms of future work, of course, we would like to use the analysis in a real path of concerts, SSA. It could be used, for example, in SSA destruction. And one point that I did not mention is that in our formalization, we wanted to use the dominance test already formalized in ComSurfSSA, but it was actually the formalization was too weak for our purpose. So we started another formalization, a stronger one based on a recent article by Georges Jadis and Tarchant. Now it is finished, but it's still an unpublished work. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for the talk, Jean-Christophe. So we have a bit of time for questions. As usual, raise your hand or type them in the Slack if you want to ask a question. Well, I've got a question. So you mentioned you have those benchmarks based on some artificial queries, given that it's not fully integrated into the ComSurf compiler phases, Jean-Christophe, right? So I wondered how sensitive those results are actually based on the query pattern you choose. Like, do you expect that when you see something similar on when you integrate them, or is this just the best you could come up with?
Actually, in our benchmark, we have some programs in common with the benchmark proposed in the original article. So we could compare a bit for these programs. And we cannot say that these queries are realistic, but actually we can compare the number of queries that is performed. And in terms of number of queries, we make a similar number of queries than the original article. So it is this set of queries is artificial, but credible.
Okay.
I would say.
Yeah, so, and the type of or the number of queries, does that depend very much on the compiler that you're using or what you're using the dominance or liveness checking test for? So are the areas the way you want to apply your formalization similar to the original papers in use cases?
Actually, I mentioned SSA destruction because it is applied in the original article on SSA destruction. So this is the question of whether there are other passes that suited for this analysis is not obvious. So certainly there are, but I'm not aware of the exact list.
All right, thanks. Any further quick questions? Going once, going twice. All right. Thanks again, Jean-Christophe. Okay.